So much. Thank you so much. Wow, what a treat. Yes, I've been there since 1993 and three children later, so it's really nice. Thank you so much for making this wonderful and early start. I'm very proud of you because all of you are really the early morning people. So thank you. Thank you for being here. Let me tell you that as we're going forward, As we're going forward, this presentation and this time together is really special. It's really a part of how we're looking at our partnership. But I'm also going to introduce you a little bit to Sesame Street itself and why we do the things we do and who we are. I'm also going to tell you a little bit about what we call Sesame Street in Communities, which is our partnership with NADCP. But more importantly, I want to show you the theory of why we're doing what we're doing and why this partnership is so critical, because each of you, as you see through this presentation, are the ones who make a difference in children's lives. So let's begin a little bit with the idea of transforming communities together. And one of the ways that we do that is through partnerships. And we believe that this partnership with the National Association of Drug Court Professionals is critical. It's critical because we have the ability to create wonderful experiences, wonderful Muppets, and wonderful content, but we're not directly on the ground reaching vulnerable children and families. We create tools and messages and wonderful interactions, but we need people such as yourselves to really drive them and participate and give them to children and families. So for those of you who were here yesterday, I kind of said a couple of statistics to you, and so just keep them in mind as we're going forward. There are 24 million children under the age of six. 24 million children under the age of six, all right? So that's a statistic that let's keep in mind as we're going through. But we also know that when we say 24 million children under six, there's a likelihood that they're in the context of a family with much more other siblings and extended family. So when we talk about making a difference, we're talking about making a difference around communities. And that's why this initiative, Sesame Street and Communities, is labeled that way, because we look at partnerships, we look at communities, and making impact. But before we even start, let's have another little Sesame moment. Yesterday I asked you to raise your hand, but today I think we're gonna make it a little more involved and together. What I'd love you to do is turn to a neighbor and see if you sat in those emptier rows by yourself. Now you have to kind of move over and turn to one another and look at one of the Muppets and think of a favorite moment that you had with one of the Muppets. Just turn to one of each other, make a new friend or an old friend, and just turn to one. Okay. All right. Thank you. It was hard to stop, right? It was a little harder to stop. Thank you. Thank you. If I always say this, if I could just turn a camera and watch all of you, the smiles on your faces were really telling. They were telling because it brings back such wonderful memories. Now, believe it or not, November 10th, 2019, we will celebrate our 50th anniversary. Woo! Thank you. Thank you. Sesame Street is a nonprofit organization who now is celebrating its 50th anniversary. And what does that mean? That means that people such as yourselves grew up on Sesame Street, are now sharing it with your children, your grandchildren, but children are sharing it with one another. Believe it or not, we're coming across three generations. It is an intergenerational experience. And it started off with one big idea. And that was that in 1969, if you recall during that period, it was the period of driving change, the civil rights movement, National Head Start came out, and the theory of looking at the vulnerability of children and families in our society started to surface. But what came about in that big idea was also that we could use media. And at that time, media was television. Television. To change the way we look at television so that it becomes an educational tool. And that was that big idea, but something else went in hand with that that most people don't know. And that was that not only is television enough, but we had to go out into the community to drive change. It was so new, nobody knew how to use television in this way. So we went out into communities, we went out into different early childhood programs, community centers, and brought the idea of this new medium directly into those communities. And just keep that in mind, because the philosophy of going to where you need to be is what we believe in so strongly. That big idea also spread around the world. It spread around the world. Believe it or not, we actually reach 183 million children in 140 countries. But often, we really are focused on the well-being of children. And our mission is designed in early childhood language, the whole child. We use that a lot. We are nurturing the whole child. And what we mean by that is that we're nurturing the well-being of every child's point of development. But as you know, in kind of marketing language and in the way we express ourselves, we like to use taglines. So our mission is to help all children grow smarter, stronger, and kinder. So keep that in mind. It's smarter, stronger, and kinder. And what that means is basically helping children in their cognitive development, their social emotional development, their physical and resiliency. It's really looking at the whole child. But instead of me talking a lot about our mission, let me show you a video that introduces you really well to our work and who we are, Sesame Street or Sesame Workshop. So let's play.
Sally, you've never seen a street like Sesame Street. Everything happens here. You'll love it. You're playing games.
It began in 1969 with a simple but powerful idea.
What's the idea of this show? Well, the idea is to teach little preschool kids some stuff that'll be useful to them in school.
Could using the power of media help children everywhere reach their highest potential?
The Children's Television Workshop.
He's now an accountant.
Sesame Street.
We found him.
And can you tell me what this is?
Stairs.
Okay. And can you tell me?
There's a lot of research on the effects of Sesame Street, and it's very convincing to me that when children watch Sesame Street, it makes a huge difference in their knowledge of concepts that will help prepare them for school. And by the time those children get to high school, their grade point averages are about 16% higher. That's a big effect.
What that does, it has a cascade effect on children who, over time, will continue to achieve because they will get off to the right start.
We've taken our proven model for early education across the globe, where local partners help us meet the specific needs of each country.
Well, Afghanistan is a great example. I mean, this is a country with 5 million children under the age of five, and only a third of them are in school.
Our production in Afghanistan teaches lessons of tolerance and acceptance and has an emphasis on girls' education, inspiring young girls to learn and dream big.
Across the world, there are 1.2 billion children under the age of nine, and 19% of those children live in India.
Poverty and circumstance prevent millions of Indian children from having any kind of quality preschool education. So, we bring it to them.
Chunky is just this vibrant, wonderful little girl who just loves the world, and when a child watches it and sees themselves on the screen, that's the best success of all.
Where are you guys?
Okay, no hiding.
At first, I didn't think she wanted to hug me because she was scared of me, maybe.
I was nervous. I was afraid it was going to change the way I was going to be a father.
Here at home, a number of initiatives focus on communities with special needs, like the families of our nation's military.
The chaplain sat me down on the couch, and I told him, I was like, I have three other sons, I was like, and I'm pregnant. Like, what am I supposed to do now?
Talk, listen, connect. Before this project Sesame Street created, there were a few resources to help service members talk to their children about what happens when they are deployed.
Our program is helping families cope with very difficult issues and reaching out to children in a way that only Sesame Street can.
I got you now. Are you down?
These characters are so powerful, and that gives us an opportunity to make a huge difference for children around the world.
The need for our mission has never been greater. If we can help kids everywhere to grow smarter, stronger, and kinder, I believe we can literally help to change the world.
So we are here together to change the world because we truly do believe that. Let me tell you also what we believe in very strongly whenever we create any piece of content, and why, again, I stress that partnering and working together is so essential. We believe very strongly in looking at child's perspective, the child development. We believe very strongly in looking at national and community partners going on the ground. And we want to tackle the most difficult issues that often are not tackled from a child's perspective. We believe in research. Everything we do, whether it's a book that you experience, our programming, or any of this community engagement, we research it thoroughly with experts, but we go directly into the community to hear from what we call providers, also the families and children themselves. We believe in the power of our Muppets. That's our secret sauce. We believe that they are trusted, and just like the experience that you felt before of connecting, of bringing memories, that's what we thrive on and what we bring the power of our Muppets with. I oversee what we call the U.S. social impact, but in real language, it's all our community and family engagement work. And we have three major areas that we look at. We look at children's early learning basics, and that means their cognitive or being prepared for school, everything from early language development, literacy, math, STEM, all those components. We also believe that in order for children to succeed, we have to look at their physical development and their resiliency. The idea of physical development means healthy habits, the nutrition, the physical activity, even oral health and all these areas that impact children's well-being. We also believe, and this is the area that we are most linked with together as partners, are those really difficult topics. And that's what we'll talk about a little bit today, about the foundation and also the neuroscience that's coming out around trauma and very difficult topics that are impacting not only the well-being of children, but actually their physical development, the development of their brains. So as we go forward, we'll look at certain terms. We'll look at trauma. We'll look at what we're calling nurturing adults. And as I was hearing you all yesterday and these wonderful stories of families and individuals surpassing and moving forward, one of the things that came about was that sense of creating a circle of care for the family, for the individual. And that's the power that we're going to discover today. There's really a new outlook in children's well-being. And that outlook is combining the neuroscience, the child development, and also community systems change. What does that all mean? It means that now through technology, we're able to actually see children's or anyone's changes in brain development or the impact of stress on the brain. On the other hand, we're also able to understand much more long-lasting effects of nurturing, but also of stress. Just as you all talked about substance abuse, depression, all these components that are challenges for adults, we're also connecting those kinds of situations or challenges to the impact, not only physically, outwardly, but inwardly in the brain. And more we know the science of it. We know the science of long-term impact, but also of short-term impact, but also what we can do to intervene. Lastly, we're also discovering the power of connecting with one another and the term nurturing, or you're using a lot of the term compassion. Compassion really, when you break it down, means that you're connecting with someone very closely. You're understanding where they are, you're supporting them. And that terminology is even more important in today's times and for children's well-being. I mentioned some of the statistics of the numbers of young children under six, 24 million, but shockingly, more than half are living near or at poverty. That's an awful lot of children being impacted by adverse experiences. We also know that there's a connection, a very strong connection between poverty and the well-being of children, but the entire family. It brings stressful situations. It brings certain adversity. And yesterday, we also heard and talked about some terms that we use, this intergenerational almost cycle of poverty. And that's very, very important. And some of this information will tell you why that happens. There's something being called now adverse childhood experiences, or ACEs in terminologies. Basically, they're traumatic experiences that impact a household. And you know many of these very, very well. Those things can include everything from maternal depression to substance abuse, food insecurity, divorce. It is really childhood or domestic violence in the household. And what they're doing now is looking at adversity and impact. Shockingly, one in four children struggle with more than one traumatic experience. All right? One in four children in our society. So you're coupling poverty, you're coupling the traumatic experiences. But let me tell you a little bit more about what the base of this study was, all right? And it's so critical to really understand that what happens in those early years impact not only in those early years, but for our future. But the one thing to take away from this is that ACEs, the number of ACEs, is not your destiny. Keep that in mind. The number of ACEs is not your destiny, but it is a warning sign. So let me tell you a little bit about how this all started to come about. In San Diego, there was really an idea of a hospital setting where a public health specialist and also a physician started to note so many people coming into emergency rooms really for constantly, repeatedly, over and over and over. And they started to want to know why. So they conceived the idea of looking at, well, if you're an adult, could what happened to you in the earlier times in your life that were adverse experiences, such as witnessing domestic violence, child abuse or neglect being impacted by that, substance abuse or mental illness in the household, parent discord, you know, that strong parental discord, criminal actions, the fact of being incarcerated, or even divorce. Do those things, as you were exposed in those early years, birth to five, have an impact for you later on? And it was a curious question. It was a curious question because very few people had looked at that kind of correlation. So the results, it was an extensive study, lots of results, but this is one of the more dramatic results, all right? So if you look at this chart, basically what it means is the number of people, all right, in this study, and it was over 17,000 individuals, all right, who reported that they witnessed some level of violence or abuse in their household. So if you look at the blue line, the highest one, that means very often they witness that. The other, the lightly green line, is often. But if you couple those two together, that's an awful lot of people of that sample who indicated that at least for this area, the frequency was very high. But as they went through, they started to find really consistent patterns. That most of those adverse experiences that we said before, domestic violence, neglect, divorce, incarceration, actually had very similar frequencies for this population. Then they started to look for those people to see the effects now as adults. And one was very, very interesting is that there was really a link between the number of adverse experiences, meaning you had one, maybe you witnessed domestic violence, or you had two, you witnessed domestic violence and maternal depression, or you had three, you had those two plus substance abuse, you had more than four, right? Those three and maybe the incarceration of a parent, okay? So the more, the higher the adverse experiences as an adult. Meaning, if you look at the chart once again, if you have more than four exposures of adverse experience, the frequency, especially for women, of depression was very, very high, over close to 55%. All right? That also meant other things. They found similar results with the frequency of heart disease. They found the significant effect of substance abuse. All right? So again, think back. What happens earlier is impacting me later. So they developed this adversity pyramid. And the adversity pyramid has the philosophy, or the ACEs pyramid, that what happens in my early years, those adverse experiences, definitely and significantly, the higher the number, and without intervening, meaning I'm not doing anything in that household to intervene, has an impact in that child's development, in their social emotional, in their cognitive development, in their ability to navigate the world. But that doesn't stop there. What they're also saying is, because I'm growing up with that level of adversity, it impacts me as I get to be a youth. It impacts me because I have a propensity to have riskier actions, riskier behavior. It also means that if I engage in that riskier behavior, it then leads to more adversity that's more physical. There's more propensity to depression or heart disease or other areas. Or, as we are all here, the propensity to engage in coping through substance abuse or other areas. And then, unfortunately, the likelihood that if I put all of that together and it becomes chronic since my early years, death, in a certain sense, is much more likely to be earlier. All right. However, as we look at this from an early childhood point of view, and remember that whole child philosophy that we have, we know now very, very strongly that the way we impact children's development and their brain development with adversity, that if there is this kind of adversity, it affects the way they learn. It also affects the way they physically develop and their mental health, their ability for resiliency. And it changes the way they can interact with the world. So that idea of our mission together of making children smarter, stronger, and kinder gets lowered because it's harder. You're impacting from the moment children are born. I'm skipping this video, it's just for the essence of time. But here's the secret. And now that I've totally depressed you, please, really, don't take it that way. I know when we say this, I look at people and say, oh my God. But this thing is that equally, the science is indicating the power of what we call nurturing, the power of compassion, the power of a connection between adults and children, making a lifetime of difference. It doesn't always have to be a parent at all, but it is someone who can connect with children to make a difference in a consistent way. But more importantly, someone who's understanding both the negative, but more importantly, what you all highlight, the positive. Because when we're looking at families and children and seeing struggles, or we're looking at individuals with struggles, most people, not all of you here, but most people tend to look at the deficits rather than the underlying strengths of individuals. So here is where caring adults make the difference. All right. So what is Sesame Street and Communities all about? Sesame Street Communities simply is the fact that we create really good resources. And I say that with pride because we take a lot of effort in each initiative that we develop, whether it's one around literacy, whether it's one about learning to go to the doctor, or whether it's one about introducing children and helping them understand from a child's perspective the incarceration of a parent. We go through research quite a bit. We created an online destination, and if all of you could just walk away with one thing, just remember it. It is SesameStreetIncommunities.org. SesameStreetIncommunities.org. This online destination houses all of this content that I'll tell you about in a second. It also houses professional development in different ways. But more importantly, what we're doing is we're developing this partnership with these resources and national and local organizations to integrate the resources in a way that's helpful to those that are servicing families. We believe in what we call the circle of care. We believe very strongly that this cannot be done with one person, one organization, or one system. We believe that in order to truly change the well-being of today's children, when you keep in mind that over 50% of children under the age of 6 are impacted, that we have to do that in the context of coming together. So we believe very strongly that in order to do that, that circle of care looks at what we call the provider system. And to us, the provider system is anyone who is really servicing at any level children and families. We look at organizations and we look at the power that organizations have to deliver content and experiences. We look at parents as critical, but we also acknowledge that many of them may be struggling and they need our support equally as well. But we also look at caregivers, and caregivers often are so critical when parents or others are struggling. That extension, but only when we unite that and look at that, do we make a change? And from what I heard of all the families who stood here, or the individuals who stood here, that is exactly what you all provided, that circle of care. So Sesame Street and Communities provides resources. It provides it in a digital format, but we also engage with national and local partnerships to create training and support. It's provided in English and in Spanish, and you have ability to save, print, use multiple resources. These resources include everything from videos using the power of Sesame Street Muppets, but also live action of real families telling about their experiences. We also have animation. We also engage in professional development because, like the way we started with our big idea, we believe you can't take something like this without learning and knowing how to use it most effectively. We have a variety of topics. As I said to you, it goes back to our mission, smarter, stronger, and kinder. But more importantly, a lot of times, it's better to show you. Now, I'm going to show you a sequence of three videos. These three videos show you a couple of things, of examples of how we are representing the child's perspective. Each of them comes really with information that we heard from the providers, from the families, from the children themselves. One has to do with divorce. It's an introduction to our divorce materials. Second one is an animation about the incarceration and a young girl's visit to see her father. Now, I know everyone's goal here is to avoid incarceration. However, from what we heard it from so many of the representatives during the time of transformation, they had prior experiences of being incarcerated. And if you heard, and I was really listening, they often said, you know, my kids wouldn't even talk to me. They wouldn't listen to me. Because, again, the kids understand very early on something is not right. But for adults, we often think that the way to solve that is by not talking about it. But we know, even with the youngest, the more we talk about it, the more important it is, because you're making a difference in helping children understand what is happening. Because believe it or not, young children come up with many ideas that are negative. We heard from our incarceration research that many children thought that the reason their parent was incarcerated was their fault. It was their fault. They did something wrong. Everything from misbehaving or not being there, it was their fault. So imagine that stigma and that lack of awareness or understanding for a long time. The last one is about trauma. You heard all the adversity, all the areas that cause trauma, those adverse childhood experiences. In trauma, we look at several things. Our perspective is not to deal with the individual trauma. In other words, we're not directly talking about substance abuse. We're not directly talking about child neglect. However, we're talking to what we call the protective factors. Again, the positive. What resiliency, despite that environment, can we help other adults share with young children to support them? So let me show you this sequence of videos, and I think you'll see both the power of Sesame Street, but more importantly, the child's perspective. We can have the video start.
I was just on my way home, to my mommy's home, but I also have another home. It's where I live with my daddy. That's because, well, my parents are divorced. And you know, I had a lot of big feelings about the divorce at first, and a lot of questions too. But by talking with my mommy and my daddy, well, it really helped me a lot. You see, they helped me to see that my mommy's always gonna be my mommy, and my daddy's always gonna be my daddy. And do you know what's most important? Is that they'll always love me, no matter what. Come on, Rexy.
This is my favorite picture of me and my daddy. He used to take me to the park all the time. But I can't right now, because my daddy's in prison. Today we're going to visit him. Me and my mom and my little brother Michael are going to take a bus. On the way, Mom reminds us about the rules of this prison. We can talk to Daddy and see him, but we're not allowed to touch him. I just can't wait to see him already. The walls are tall at the prison, with lots of gates and wires everywhere. I hold Mom's hand a little tighter as we walk in, and she lets me know it's okay. Sometimes, we have to wait online a long time before we can see my daddy. We pass through loud gates that open and close behind us. Then we go into another room where we have to wait again. Finally, my daddy comes in. His hair is a little longer than last time. It's good to see him. At first, I forget everything I want to tell him. But then we start talking and it gets easier. Daddy says how proud he is of us for helping Mom at home and for all the things we're learning. It's hard not to be able to touch or hug each other, but Daddy blows me a kiss. I tell him I'll save it for later. Before we know it, it's time to go already. I don't want to say goodbye. I wish Daddy could come with us, but this is where he has to be because he broke a law. But we all look forward to the next time we can come and visit again. As we take the bus back home, I think about Daddy going back to what he does in prison. And I know he'll be thinking about me, just like I'm thinking about him.
Well, thank you, Alan. You give the best hug.
Oh, anytime, Big Bird. You need one, you just ask. You feel any better?
A little bit. Ooh, I'm gonna go get my teddy bear Rega. I'll be right back.
Okay, anything that helps. When children experience trauma, it can affect them in many ways. They can have big feelings that can seem overwhelming at times. But children need to know they're not alone. They need us grown-ups, family, and friends to help them through. You can lend an ear to listen, a shoulder to cry on, or even offer words of hope. There's always something you can do to make a difference in the life of a child.
Alan!
Big Bird!
Alan, hey, Radar could use a hug too.
Oh, sure. Come here, Radar. How's that?
That's
good?
Great, yeah. Okay. See, Radar? I told you that Alan can help you feel better.
Okay, one of the messages that you got in that last video was the sense of children feeling alone. So as we started to do a lot of our research, we found that even though 2.6 million children a year experience the incarceration of a parent, and it's actually expected to be around over 4 million children that are impacted by a parent going in through the justice system. So many children and families that we talk to at different ages, whether young or older in youth, felt that they were the only one who had experienced that. The only one. So what happens a lot of times in adversity is that families, but particularly children, but even the adults around them, feel so isolated and the hole is so deep that they often feel, I am the only one experienced this and there's no way out. So when you see this kind of content and this kind of experience, not only are you sharing strategies, but you're also giving the message that these incidents, these unfortunate situations, not only can you move forward, but that you are not alone. You are not the only one experiencing it, although millions around you are. Now, the other area that we work on, we work in three major areas. We work in Sesame Street communities. We work also, for those of you who may have seen recently, a whole effort around autism, understanding autism. We recently launched in our programming an autistic Muppet who is 4 years old by the name of Julia. But equally, we also work with our military families, work, and we're very proud of this. We have several sayings that reflected through the military as we evolved. Believe it or not, it's over 11 years that we've been engaged in this effort. And we believe very, very strongly those mantras that say, when a service member serves, the entire family serves. We also believe when a service member is injured, the entire family is injured. When a service member transitions back into civilian life, the entire family transitions. But those latter two, the injuries and the transition back into civilian life, often we lose the context of family, and particularly, once again, the perspective of young children. So as I mentioned, we have a wonderful work around military families to support them through what we call all the milestones through military family transitions. Those include, as I said, returning to civilian life. We worked on deployments. We also not only worked on deployments, but homecoming, because as we know, homecoming is also a major transition. We've worked on grief. You saw a snippet of that in our first video, dealing with the death of a parent. And we tackled even death by suicide. So in our military families work, we realized that that was happening, unfortunately, frequently, and we needed to address that as well. We also have dealt with injuries, both visible and invisible. And explaining an invisible injury to a young child is really difficult, because why is daddy or mommy suddenly very different than and acting very different and not being my mommy or daddy? We've also done very, very much easier things. Believe me, we do some easier things, relocation and self-expression. And in September, we'll be launching even more resources. And in this, we have a very simple website that gives you, it's called SesameStreetForMilitaryFamilies.org. And again, the resources are there. Let me play you a little bit of a video that I have here.
Elmo, what is it like after your daddy gets back?
When daddy comes back home. But sometimes it's a little hard too. Yeah. Now we have to remember that daddy is here. And we can do things with daddy too. Like reading bedtime stories and making Elmo's lunch. It takes a little while, but pretty soon Elmo and mommy get used to having daddy home again. Elmo knows you'll get used to having your mommy or daddy back too.
So that gives you a sense of a child's perspective. And for what we found in our research in coming and having a homecoming for families is that it was really hard to readjust, because suddenly you set up routines and suddenly there was he or she was back and it was really difficult. But we also dealt with our latest work, which is transitions back into civilian life. And from this, we made lots of discoveries. We found several things that were, I think for the first time, when we did our initial research of getting the advisors and everyone to guide us on this, and then going directly into families who were experiencing transition, were still on duty and making the transition, or already veteran families, we found different findings between the top and the actual families. So when we started doing our research at the very top, we found that they said to us very strongly, these are families that are going to maintain their military identity. They are a military family forever, forever. And they must maintain their identity as that. And then we created lots of prototype resources and went out to test it. And guess what? I think for one of the first times, they said, family said to us, boy, this is really not what we want. A, this is kind of depressing, too long, too much. You know, first of all, What they said to us is, when we are making a transition back into civilian life, we're going back into civilian life. We hold military values, but we're not a military family anymore. We hold values. So that's really important. Two, you know what? We're overwhelmed enough. There's a very strong likelihood that I am now a caregiver, and my partner, my spouse, whomever it is, he or she may have certain challenges, and now I'm in that position. We're struggling to look for housing or new path in education or jobs. It is very, very stressful. So the last thing they wanted from Sesame was for us to stress, provide more stress and put the challenges. They said, what we need from you is a sense of adventure. Make this experience much more lively for us, an adventure. And so we created the Big Adventure campaign. And what we meant by that, we provided a series of 12 experiences. And those 12 experiences took the steps of transitioning from a child's point of view and very much gave it a very sense of uplifting and hopefulness for the future. I bring this up because I'm going back to trauma to leave you with some thoughts on this as well. When you are looking at the effects of trauma, remember what I said, ACEs does not define you. And the same thing here. When you're looking for a sense and you're looking at the perspective of hope for the future, the hope for the future is really individuals such as yourself intervening and providing a positive path forward. Believe it or not, what we found so strongly, no matter what the topic that we did, whether it was incarceration, whether it was even literacy, was that if you present a way to empower that adult, give them a step forward of the difference that they could make with their children, suddenly the perspective is so different. This perspective is different because they themselves feel, I have to help my child, I have a responsibility, but I could make a difference. But more importantly, I'm being treated with respect despite my challenges. So the same learnings came, believe it or not, here. Let me show you one last video for transitions. It's an animation of little Elmo. This one I can't act.
Elmo. Oh, hi, Katie.
Hi.
Look what I picked up for you at the store, son.
Ooh, a new backpack. Just what you'll need for your first day of school.
If you don't like it, we can take it back and get another one.
It's fine. It's just, well, Elmo's nervous about going to a brand new school. It's so different than what Elmo's used to.
Son, I know changes can be hard at first, but it'll be all right. Isn't that true, Katie?
It really will. I've been through lots of changes, Elmo. When my dad left the military, we had to move. Coming to live in the city was a huge change. Everything was so different. I had a lot of big feelings about all the changes, but my parents helped me through it and showed me that even though things had changed, it was also exciting. It was the start of a new adventure. It didn't take long to get used to the changes.
So, Believe it or not, that's a little bit of an exposure to both what we hope to partner and do together, the resources, the strategy, the knowledge, but more importantly, using the brand of Sesame Street to help families through the National Association of Drug Court Professionals. We want to bring this content, this brand, that experience that we all started off together in naming our favorite Muppet as part of our partnership. So we're truly honored and grateful to be here. But more importantly, our goal is that together we can help children grow smarter, stronger, and kinder. And we're here to thank you for allowing us to be here and to share this partnership. Thank you very much.